Hey, everybody. Thank you for joining our session today. So I just got to go over some quick housekeeping for you guys. Today, our session ends, our sessions end today at 5:15. And at the close of today, we're going to give away some door prizes. And just so you know, you had to be present to be able to win those. Then after that part, we have like a dinner break from about 5:30 to 6:30. I'm sorry, from 5:30 to 6:30. But also during that time period, we have some special interest groups. And those groups include women in GIS, GIS leadership, GIS early career, enterprise and natural resources, and environmental. So be sure to go to one of those if you want to. Also, be sure to check out the NCAEG merchandise on the conference page because, there are some pretty cool stuff over there, but also all that goes to the scholarship funds. So that's really helpful. And just so you guys know, the recordings for this session and all the other sessions will go on the NCAUG YouTube page. So it won't be immediately. So just give it a little bit of time, but it will be up there for you guys. So yeah, let's get to our session. So again, thank you and welcome thank you for attending this session. So we're gonna talk about mapping on the fly, and it's integrating GIS with low cost sensors to provide continuous real-time flood inundation and impact analysis. And today we have Neal Banerjee from ESP Associates and James Scanlon from Mecklenburg County. So with Neal has quite, impressive, resume, I guess. He's a water resource department manager for ESP in Charlotte, and he has over 25 years experience. And his experience includes working with FEMA, CTP flood insurance study updates, municipal master plans and drainage projects, flood mitigation planning, stream restoration, data collection, and GIS database development for a variety of different projects. And he has a very specific expertise with integration of forecast and observed rainfall and stream data in support of storm event preparation and response, and also the development of real-time warning and mapping systems for state agencies and municipalities in the Carolinas and Virginia. So that's a lot of stuff right there. And also about Neal, he holds a master's degree in civil engineering from University of North Carolina in Charlotte. And he also has a bachelor's in civil engineering and anthropology from the University of Illinois. So when it comes to questions for the session, if you don't mind to just wait until after the presentation and we can get to those questions for you. And also the final thing, I guess, is just for the continuing education credit, just make sure that your Zoom login just has your full name. So, okay, you guys are ready to take it away, I guess.
Great. Thank you. So as I said, I'm Neal Banerjee with ESP. I've got James Scanlon with Mecklenburg County with me. He'll help answer questions at the end. So we've been working on a project the last couple of years. It's part of actually a larger project, but I think it's very timely with all the flooding in Tennessee and Hurricane Ida. So we want to share the part that's focused on this presentation is the integration with these low-cost sensors with real-time mapping. So here's the general outline. I'll give a general outline of the Mecklenburg County Charlotte framework of the project, and then kind of dive into the storm event tools. And whether you say fortunate or unfortunate, we had an event during the development of this project, so we had some interesting validation to compare. I imagine most of you are familiar with Mecklenburg County, but if not, I believe it's still the most populated county in North Carolina. You can see I have a bunch of metrics on the page, but really the takeaway is, it has a very high flood risk. There's lots of miles of FEMA floodplain mapping, thousands of buildings in the floodplain. So Mecklenburg County, along with the state of North Carolina, I think is safe to say is, two of the top programs probably in the country that other programs look to as far as, flood mitigation, flood hazard mapping. So Mecklenburg County in particular, and you can see a list there, they have a lot of really innovative and progressive initiatives. And hopefully this is just another one to add to their impressive list. Here's just some screenshots, you know, just to name a few. They've had an active flood warning system for a number of years. You know, they have their own local flood mitigation grant program, which is, I think, pretty unique in the whole country. You know, lots of websites, so they're always pushing the envelope. So kind of what the project that we're going to talk about is, it actually started a couple years ago, 2018. They entered in a collaborative agreement with what's called the FEMA Flood Apex Program. And so what that basically is FEMA's, or the DHS's, kind of R&D arm, which is always looking into emerging technologies. And so it was a three-year project. It had a couple parallel tracks, which I'll get to in a second. One track was this low-cost sensor technology, and the second track was building tools and evaluating risk. And at the end, which we're at now, is where we pulled the tracks together. So on a graphical overview, this is kind of, you'll hear me use the terms base year, option year one, and option year two. Those are just contract year terms, but as you can see, there's the top tier of the flood sensors what we're calling these RAR tool enhancements. And then option year two, that's where they come together. And that's really the main focus of this presentation, but I'll give some background on the other two. So I think one reason that Mecklenburg County in particular was a good grantee for DHS is because, you know, this is a high flood risk urban community, like I mentioned, but probably more importantly, the county has, you know, they have the data. There's a tremendous amount of data that the county has, you know, collected and that aid into making this all work. And they have the infrastructure and the resources to pull this off. So especially in the flood sensor side, you know, that they didn't, I'll get into in a bit, but they installed, you know, 100 plus sensors and the maintenance and so forth. So DHS needed someone that could actually pull this off. And really the hope, you can see I have them listed there at the bottom, but was, I think, well, several prong, but it was to kind of really test this emerging technology. You know, there's been USGS gauges out for a long time, but I think really the challenge has been the cost of deploying those. So many areas, many urban areas in the country do not have any sort of monitoring. So this low cost sensors are very intriguing because the cost is much, much less than your traditional gauge network. And then trying to marry these up with data tools and framework to help give flood event situational awareness. So obviously this project is gonna directly help Mecklenburg County in their flood mitigation efforts, but part of the grant is also the county sharing with, you know, the lessons learned and the techniques that we've developed. So from the low-cost sensor path, so this is that top path. So the county did this pretty much all on their own. So ESP, we were not directly involved. So in a quick summary, there's within the three contract years, the first year was primarily to test different vendors and to really hone in on the reliability, performance, durability, those kind of aspects. So they installed a limited number of gauges from multiple vendors at the same site, and they were trying to figure out, you know, does this even work? And are there advantages and disadvantages? In option year one, it moved, they kind of honed in on a single vendor, and then it's how do we deploy these and how do we actually use these for active flood warning and long-term mitigation planning? And that continued in the option year two. So just, you know, high level, they ended up installing over 100 of these low-cost sensors. And if you've ever seen NC Fiman or the Mecklenburg County FIN systems, they already have a fairly extensive gauge network, 50 plus gauges. So this low-cost sensors is used to supplement the information that provides. So collectively, they cover 39 of the county streams, and they allow for monitoring of about 230 miles, covering about 95% of the flood risk. And I'll better define that in a few minutes. Here's just a few pictures. First picture on the top left, you can see this is when in the base year when they had three different vendors and they installed them at the same location and were trying to figure out, you know, how consistent are these readings. The other pictures are hardware, but if you're a community, you've probably heard about these low-cost sensors. The county did a you know, really great job. One of the deliverables to the DHS was a sort of this guidebook that goes into a lot of detail of what you need, how much effort it takes, how to install these, you know, the pitfalls, how to maintain them. So there's a guidebook and you can see the link up there. So that's a public, it's a DHS, I guess, a public document. So I'd encourage you, if you're even thinking at all about how feasible you could, these are, if you're a community, I'd recommend you go to that link. Here's just a quick map. The orange dots are the low-cost sensors, and the blue triangles are the USGS gauges. So you can see that there's kind of scattered all over the county with concentrations in the central corridors. The reason for that being that's where a lot of the risk, that's the older portions, that's the uptown area, the older portions of the city that have the most flood vulnerability, the most complex drainage system. So, you know, in general, one of the things that they had to think about is how do we strategically deploy these to get the best bang for our buck. And, you know, it's basically you put them where you need the more resolution and the detail. And those tend to be in higher density, older urbanized areas. So on the separate path, we'll call it the RAR path. That's the tools and the framework. So again, we had, again, the 3 years. So the first year was basically to replicate and migrate the framework they had developed previously. Option year one, we added a bunch of tool enhancements. We developed a dashboard and a community guidebook. And then option year two, which is more of the focus of this presentation, is the integration with the low-cost sensors. So what the RAR framework is it could easily be a one or two presentations by itself, but it's basically sets of data and tools and logic that allow the county to evaluate in a detailed fashion, evaluate flood risk, mitigation alternatives, and prioritize them at a building and property level. So it uses this multi-tier scoring system to, you know, make sense of all that. But they use this, one of the, I'd say, progressive elements of the county's flood mitigation program is they refer to it as a goals-driven approach, where they want to have data-driven to say, let's define how do we define what the risk is and how do we quantify, you know, the benefits, so they can continually track the effectiveness of the program, the return on investments, and use it for budgeting. So they say, you know, we have X amount of risk and we think a realistic target is to get down to here. Well, we need to do these projects, it's going to cost that much. So this is the information they use every year when they're getting their annual budgets. The thing that, and this is where that detailed data comes in, you know, the county has invested a lot of time, money, resources over the years to really, you know, most communities already have, you know, parcel data and elevation certificates, but I think what the county, Mecklenburg County, has done a great job with is pulling that valuable information. You know, some of it's for regulatory purposes, some of it's for, you know, FEMA floodplain mapping, you know, compiling that and pulling it all together so it can be integrated. So this RAR system uses a bunch of very detailed building information. It has all the floor elevations, you know, lowest adjacent grade, mechanical elevations. It's getting flood information from the FEMA model. So they all 300 plus miles in the county are detailed studies with these multi-frequency. You know, we're getting you know, occupancy type, building use characteristics, values from the parcels, and there's a whole bunch of other layers. So there's a tremendous amount of data underneath, I mean, that the county's already has and collected that kind of support the framework. And the reason why I call it a framework is there's, you know, some of that data changes, probably like many other urban areas. Charlotte has been growing like a weed, so there's constant development, redevelopment, and so they didn't want to just set something that's static. So as, you know, floodplains change or development changes, you know, these tools can consume this data and then, you know, recompute all these flood and mitigation statistics. I'm not going to, again, this could be a whole separate different presentation, but on the RAR tool framework, there's assessing the risks. And so we look at 17 criteria of what's the nature of the flooding, you know, what does it impact, whether it's the floor elevation or just the mechanical machinery, or it surrounds the building. You know, what kind of building is it? Is it critical use? So there's a bunch of scoring on that side. Then once it evaluates the risk, then it goes through and says, okay, based on all these site conditions, which mitigation techniques would be, you know, technically effective and, you know, feasible? And then it'll go and rank those. And so the end of the RAR the end result of the RAR process is you have building level data of risk, what to do about it. And then there's a priority score so they can use it to say, these are the next 20 projects we need to do. A sister tool to the RAR is called the LAT. So this is actually storm related, but one of the proactive things the county has done over the last, I guess, 20 years is they've areas where they have been very high flood risk, they've bought out, I think, 450 plus structures, and they're doing mitigation projects. Some of, if you've been to Charlotte, some of the marquee, like the Little Sugar Creek Greenway, the Chantilly Ecological Area, those were all buyout projects that they turned into, you know, hugely successful public amenities. So what they want to do of that, again, this is part of the goals-driven thing, is when they purchase something and a storm hits, they want to know, well, how much money did we save, or how much damage was avoided by us mitigating that structure? So we have tools that will assess that, and that's, they kind of roll into the RAR system. So kind of similar to the gauges, so the base year and the option year one highlights, you know, a lot of the work was kind of revamping the data sources, making things more efficient. Option year one, we added a bunch of enhancements to account for even more things than before. So that what that means literally or tangibly is these are desktop tool sets. We had probably 60 plus tools of Model Builder and Python that, you know, crunch all this data, and as the data changes, it crunches it again, that account for all this. And the successes from the option year, or the base year and the option year one, was, you know, these tools run a whole lot faster and provide more information. Here's just some kind of random screenshots of data sets and improvements that we did. And, you know, again, everything is, it's calculated at the building level and can be rolled up, you know, to whatever aggregate is meaningful. Just some examples of, you know, all the tool sets and toolbars and models and so forth. So one other element of option year one, you know, again, this is going with the sharing, you know, what we're learning and doing with others. There's this public guidebook, again, that hopefully it gives a really good, walks you through from, you know, depending on where you're at with what data you have in the community, of how to get more data, and then steps you all the way through from getting the data, you know, developing things to assess your risk and mitigation, but also, you know, the county has been very successful in obtaining grants. And how do you fund this? How do you talk to your city council or county commission? How do you make this, how do you take it from just modeling and hypothetical to actual mitigation projects? So there's chapters in that as well. So again, I have the link there. It's a public DHS document that I think came out great. One other enhancement is a part of option year one that we, and I'll get to in a second, that we've added with option year two, is this RAR dashboard. So there's just a ton of data and metrics and things that we capture as part of all these tools. And so we built this. This is a custom dashboard, but, you know, it looks kind of similar to the AGOL type dashboards, but you can point and click and use the sliders to always see, you know, where the risk is. And you can see the top metrics, the metrics at the top of some of that is risk. Some of that is, you know, how much is it going to cost me to address the risk? How much, you know, how much like a unit cost per reducing the point? So a great way to communicate the information. And, you know, there's all sorts of custom widgets and sliders and programming tools and tracking. So again, this could be a whole separate presentation. So with that said, that again, the focus, so the one difference between the one paradigm shift between the first couple of years in this last year was those first 2 years on the RAR side are planning, you know, hypothetical programmatic kind of support. This last year, the option two is bringing that to saying that, okay, I want to be able to help and translate what's happening on the ground. So what we did is we added two new, I guess, suites of tool, if you will, that will, this is where the paths converge, where we say, hey, we have all these data points, the low-cost sensors and USGS gauges out there that are giving us real-time data feeds that, you know, every 5 to 10 minutes, it's saying this is what the stage in the stream is. So we want to capture that and be able to map it and put it in a meaningful sense. So there's two sets. There's this RAR now and the RAR storm. And I'll go into more detail in a second. But it's integrating, you know, this is, you know, the actual pulse on the ground. So really the main functions of the tools are first to go out and get all this data. Then there's a whole bunch of processing, you know, with combining the data that's seen on the ground with all these foundational data sets, you know, the buildings and, you know, parcels and floodplains and everything else, and then writing that to the databases that are consumed by the web application. So the tool sets, RAR now, so this is kind of like the real time. So the way we have it set up now is I believe all the low cost sensors are on a cellular network. So the county has a contrail system. So we dip in through the API and we go and pull that. So we get the data. And what the RAR now does is just says, what is the latest reading? So we can put it on the scheduler to run every, you know, 5-10 minutes. So it's constantly checking. And what it will do is, if it's a mappable event, meaning it's more than a 2-year event or a 50% annual chance, it will develop floodplain mapping for both the current and sort of a forecast as well. And so what that gives you is the what is happening now situational awareness. So this would be used more by, you know, people, emergency responders during the event. And since they have, you know, such a good solid network, you know, we can capture a lot of information. Sort of similar tools, but kind of from a different angle, the RAR storm or the post event. So this is usually run either during a long storm or right after a big storm, where we say, I want to know what was the worst case flooding, you know, throughout the county. So it goes against the contrail system and pulls out the maximum values. And so this, you know, there's a lot of work the county has traditionally had to do kind of pseudo manually to pull all this information together to feed, to really aid in the recovery and the response. Excuse me. Here's kind of a graphical workflow. I mean, some of the algorithms and tools are similar between the two tool sets, but, you know, again, it's getting data, you know, processing data and feeding the data out so that web application can see it. A little bit in the weeds, some of the data extraction. So this stuff is all written in Python. We initiate the API calls, get the XMLs, you know, we convert that, and then we basically populate geodatabases. And then the tools themselves are still run in a desktop environment. So they take this gauge data and then integrate it with, you know, with that foundational data to say, okay, we have points on a map that say stage, we need to turn that into a floodplain boundary or flood inundation boundary. And then, you know, in the case of the RAR now, we have that set up to a scheduler. Here's just some interface examples of the RAR now and storm tools. So the second set is processing the data. So, you know, again, we're just getting point data from these gauges. That each gauge is giving us, I mean, the main, it collects more things, but the main thing we're interested in is the stream stage. So these are kind of discrete dots along the streams. Well, to make that more meaningful, we need to say, well, a stage of 16 feet relates to what on the ground, and how do we connect the dots? So that's what the we've got algorithms set up that will do that work. Once we get the inundation boundary, then we can overlay that with all our built environment foundation data sets to say, okay, what's being impacted? How badly is it being impacted? And so this involves, you know, hundreds of geospatial and tabular computations every time the tool is run. So a little bit about how does this work? I mean, you know, we don't have time, certainly during an event, Mecklenburg County, you know, pretty much all the water, the flood waters in Mecklenburg County, the large majority of it, except for the Catawba River, originates in Mecklenburg County. So, you know, a storm here, it rains and, you know, the streams go up and down very quickly. So we don't have time to develop new models to figure all this stuff out. But what we do have time to do is to leverage all that modeling that they've already done and use some of the derivative data sets to help us inform something that's model informed, but not modeled during the event. So you can see I have a general logic workflow. It's actually using the recurrence interval. So it's not trying to linearly interpolate like actual elevations, but it's using recurrence interval and this thing called the percent annual chance raster. And so from that, we can take these points, these discrete points with readings, and turn it into a continuous floodplain boundary in minutes. And then we have other processes that then kind of back calculate out what the water surface elevation is and depth raster. So I'll show you some examples. Excuse me. So here's kind of a graphical, the stuff on the left, that's kind of like the point readings at the gauges. We generate these interpolation surfaces, you know, run it through the PAC, but the end product, you know, and this is a small sample, is a continuous, you know, real depth raster and water surface elevation raster. So you can, you know, point and click and see what's the depth of water here, you know, what, how much is it at that building, or what's the elevation? How does that compare to the finished floor? So finally, once all that processing is done, you know, the tools have a commit process to kind of push it up to the enterprise database. And we have a series of map services. Some of them for the RAR are kind of pre-published and they're just overwritten. In the storm event, we have it structured such that it's named and structured in such a format that when it's pushed up, the websites kind of automatically recognizes it. So here's kind of, I showed you the RAR dashboard before. So what we did for this option year two is we added this storm event analysis tool. And so this is, has all the gauges and their mitigation properties and other data, but it has a similar look and feel, but you can go and pick. So we put some hypothetical storms in, but you can either look at what's happening now, or if an event has been run and archived and committed to the database, it will show up in as well. So when you're zoomed out, it, you know, it's kind of zoom dependent metrics of who's being impacted, what's the estimated damages, you know, how much would it cost to mitigate it? And this is for both buildings, roadways, and stream crossings, or I guess that's three things. So what is this, what are these tools actually doing? And this is what I think is makes me the most proud is, so we're getting, so there's hundreds of gauges along these streams, and you know, each gauge is reading every 5 to 10 minutes. So it's, especially in the post-event storm, it's pulling, you know, up to say 50,000 records of data, processing that data to either figure out the latest reading or the maximum reading over a user-defined time. Then it's developing, you know, so these are not pre-stage libraries. These are on the fly developing flood inundation boundaries and these raster products. And it depends on, you know, how, where it's raining, but if we get a rain event that affects much of the county, the way the gauges are set up, it can map up to 230 miles of floodplain boundaries. Then it's taking that information and identifying and characterizing impacts to bridges, roads, and crossings. So the RAR now has sort of a simplified, because that has to run really quick, but the RAR storm is robust. It adds in estimated damage, like dollar impacts, to hundreds of thousands of buildings. And, you know, kind of a sister thing that would feed that LAT tool would be, you know, for those 400 properties that they bought, what is the avoided damage by, you know, what would have been the damage if those structures were still there? So generally this process runs, again, kind of depending on the number of gauges that get activated and which, you know, which options, in the 5 to 15 minute range. And so it's doing all these calculations and producing products that quickly, which is pretty mind blowing. So the, you know, this, we were very proud of all this. We thought we had great ideas. Well, during the development of this, so we started this last phase. We really didn't start till probably August, July of last year. So November 2020 comes around, I think it was November 12th. We'd had many of the concepts in place and some of the tools, but you know, the stuff was not fully built out yet. They get an event, 2 to 5 inches of rainfall, which is not a crazy amount, but it was concentrated over a 6-hour period over the morning of the 12th, much of it kind of through that central corridor where that's where most of the risk is, in the Little Sugar Creek, Uptown, Briar Creek areas. So there was impacts to hundreds of buildings and, you know, miles of inundated roads. So even though we didn't have everything fully set up, we were able to take the draft tools that we had developed and, you know, combine that with some, you know, manual steps, because we'd figured out the logic. So we were able to produce 200 miles of mapping and provide, you know, not only the boundaries, but the building and roadway impacts, you know, that same day, so they could communicate it with that emergency responders, you know, the response of going back and seeing what buildings were actually damaged and assess those. After we kind of, the other nice thing about this is, you know, after we were able to finish the data is still in contrail, so we were able to retroactively run it to kind of do the formal run. Here's a graphic of the one on the left is kind of the rainfall recurrence probability, but you can see this is the areas flooded. This was Irwin Creek, if you're familiar with Charlotte, Central Avenue. Again, there's you know, several feet of flooding. So this is some of the products that we were able to kind of partially, you know, manually, partially tool develop these impacts of, you can see that we have categorized, you know, again, it's, so it's not even, it's not just saying this water touches the building. It's like, well, since we know the building, the living space, you know, the lowest adjacent grade, the highest adjacent grade, we can define how the buildings are being impacted. So the lower left graphic that shows the kind of the red outlines is where the mapping was produced in this event. So interestingly enough, so we were able to, we sent out survey crews to kind of, you know, ground truth. The county sent out independent folks to inspect buildings. So here's I picked an example where it was very good, but you know, where this was a flood depth product that we produced, and then it compared very well with the actual field surveyed measurements. And this area was not actually all that close. I think it was a mile or two upstream of a gauge. So it wasn't like it was like right at the gauge. This is kind of what it looks like in the dashboard. So this is done sort of after the fact. So when you zoom in, you know, it color codes the buildings and color codes the roads. You know, when you're zoomed in, this is that same Bryant Street area. You know, you have these metrics of what's impacted, what's the damage, what's the cost to mitigate it. Sort of a function that we added, you know, kind of later in the game was these reports that could be downloaded and, you know, emailed. So, you know, again, even though the metrics you see in the dashboard are kind of rolled up, we have the individual buildings, so we know, you know, which building addresses and use types, and we have that data so that can be easily exported and shared. On the roads, you can see to the right, we kind of have the summary of roll-ups based on, you know, how you're zoomed in. But similar to the buildings, you have a couple of options to kind of dive into the individual road segments. So if you're trying to figure out which roads need to be closed off or which have a depth of greater than, you know, X feet, you know, that information all gets computed in the tools. So some of the event takeaways, you know, overall, you know, we were pleased with the performance that we were able to, even though, you know, we're still kind of in progress at the time, that what used to take, you know, it was a much more manual process to kind of pull that data together. We were able to get that to the county, and they in turn were able to get it to their emergency responders and everyone else who needed that information much quicker. You know, full disclosure, it did reveal some caveats, you know, areas where, you know, there was a disconnect. It was either showing, you know, some impacts that didn't happen or vice versa. So we, you know, we analyzed those areas. And in most cases, it wasn't a problem with the algorithm. It was either something in the underlying data, or it's just, you know, one of the underlying caveats is like we have all these modeled events, and in the real event, something happened that did not kind of match that response. So we did make some changes also with like gauges going down during these events. You know, you might have debris taking things out. So we need to make sure that, you know, hey, if a gauge got taken out of service, it didn't make the system bomb. So how we took those lessons learned, you know, we added some more validity checks on the front end. So as it's getting that data, it's doing some checks to make sure it's valid. We refined some underlying data sets, and it also helped the county inform, like, hey, here's an area that we probably need to redirect or redistribute some of the gauges. We may have more than we need here and not enough here. So, you know, it also provided, information on that. So in summary and some next steps, so we've been working with the county and DHS to develop this framework to, you know, integrate this real time or this low cost sensors. You know, with these things are much cheaper. They give the ability to see what's on the ground, and they can be kind of scattered, and they can be moved as well. It's, you don't have to have them in the same place. So where we're at the project, the formal DHS part of the project kind of wrapped up earlier this year, and we've just recently migrated the database, the web application, and all the tools to the county, and they have it set up on their system. We haven't had a storm to test it quite yet, not saying we want one real anytime soon. So that, you know, we'll be working through that. And the county, they rolled it out to local stakeholders. I guess it was just last week. So emergency managers, other local communities within the county to say, hey, town of Min Hill, you know, next time a storm happens, this is the data, you know, this is a system that we have. So we're sharing that with the local communities and soliciting feedback. And kind of throughout the process, we had been identifying things, particularly with the forecasting element and you know, many others. So we're going to be working with the county on doing those. So the one thing I wanted to end on is, you know, overall this, I think what really made this successful and hopefully will continue to be a success is, you know, the county and the community as a whole. You have to get it from the county commissioners and city councils, their recognition of risk, especially in, you know, changing climate, and their commitment and investment in data and technology, and their willingness to, you know, try to leverage whatever partnerships they can with, you know, whether it be FEMA or, you know, other, any grant agencies or even other communities or the DOT to make these projects possible. And I think with that, it's a wrap.
Yeah, if there's any questions, let me check the chat real quick. I think we took care of the first question that I saw. But yeah, if you guys don't mind to fill out this exit poll, that would be greatly appreciated. So can you see the chat question right there? He's wondering, so yeah, Sierra's wondering if you're looking for any help in Charlotte.
You mean like, are we hiring for any positions? If that's the case, then I would just go to mecnc.gov and check our jobs listing. I can't speak to any particular GIS related jobs, but we have a pretty big department, so doing different things in GIS, not just stormwater. So yeah, mecnc.gov. Jobs link probably the best place to start. And if you want to email me directly, I can help you with that process if needed. Next question here, what is the average cost of the LCS? What type of connectivity do they use? The cost is a little bit of a gray area. We received this as part of a DHS grant. You know, DHS partnered with these different vendors to test their equipment. And we received it kind of in exchange for in-kind services with the testing and developing all the publications associated with this project. So I can't quote you a cost. We have not like procured any through that route. Everything has been routed through DHS or USGS at no cost to us directly. So if you wish to learn more, I would look up IntelliSense. And I can put that in the chat here in a moment. That is the type of sensor that we use. Might be able to get a cost from them, but things are kind of maybe at production stage, but maybe not quite yet. We've been doing beta testing and we're just now getting production grade units to deploy in the field. So that's just, we're still at the kind of the end of the beginning as far as all that's concerned. As far as the connectivity they use, these are all kind of considered IoT devices that operate through cellular modems and call out data directly to our, they send packets to their server and to our Contrail server. We just have like a mechanism for receiving those communications and then communicating the telemetry, like stage and battery readings, et cetera, from the units. So I hope that answers the question. I think there's different means of communication. I think there's like sat links and radio frequencies as well. Do they use 5G or legacy 4G? I'm not sure they use either 5G or 4G. I would refer you back to our project landing page. There's a contact on there named Ryan Spidell. He really oversees all of the specifications and installations of these units. So he has all the information. I believe they're on some sort of alternate band that's not either 5G or 4G.
On the cost, this is just secondary information that I think I've heard. I've heard some of these sensors can run in the, you know, the $500 range to the, you know, probably the low thousands, but I'm not sure if those are the same grade as these or not.
Yeah, there's probably different units that can kind of approximate the same information. The real cost is in operating and maintain, you know, operating and maintaining these units, like especially a large network like we have. You know, there's going to be a cell bill every month. And you know, you're going to have to replace them. I don't know how long they're going to last. That's just kind of, we're still evaluating all that. So there are like kind of, you know, servicing costs above and beyond just the cost of the unit itself.
I think in that urban installation guidebook, if I remember right, the county laid out, yeah, it wasn't so much the hardware, but the time it took to install and things like that. So that there's the internal, whether it's cost or resources necessary to do that. I think that's in that guidebook, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, let me share my screen real quick. I'll give a plug to the, you know, part of this whole project was to do outreach for the benefit of, you know, all communities. So, you know, we want people to contact us if they have questions or interest and want to follow up. You can certainly contact me directly or visit our landing page, which has all of the technical resources related to this project. I'll call attention to the community guidebook. And I intentionally placed the community guidebook above sensors because the sensors are what, you know, sticks out about this project. But what really makes what we're trying to do more powerful is having the detailed risk assessment data that we can plug in and integrate with the feeds and inundation mapping that the sensors are helping us produce. That's what gives us not only the enhanced information for our first responders and helps us monitor events much better and respond as well, but you know, it helps us develop a communication and mitigation strategy that's more proactive and more effective and hopefully reduces the need for response going forward as we continue to eliminate risk. I also wanted to plug the NCAFPM Fall Floodplain Institute. That's coming up next month in October. We're gonna have at least three presentations there from our staff related to the flood inundation mapping and the sensor installation, two different presentations, and also information on developing a goal-driven CIP program so that you can monitor your risk reduction over time and really watch your strategy you know, take hold over time and develop a long-term strategy that you can communicate to elected officials in the community. And this is the landing page for the flood management risk tools and flood sensors. So all these technical resources are here. You can see there's lots of PDF links just going over all 3 years of the project. So there's really a lot of information and there's different contact information, people who know, have different technical and managerial expertise for all aspects of this program. So we want to help those that are, you know, interested in learning more about this.
All right. Thank you, everybody. I think that concludes it for today. But yeah, feel free to reach out to them if you guys have any more questions about anything. They'll for sure help you.
Thank you all. And thank you to Neal and ESP. You know, this has been an amazing partnership in developing all these tools. And I really just have to give them all the kudos in the world for being able to, you know, help us implement this vision with the technology piece. You know, absolute brilliance.
Thank you so much for attending. You may now disconnect.